Normally, I have to get everyone to quiet down before we get started, but thank you for taking your seats nicely. Welcome to the Austin Fast Start Small Business Pitch, competition for FinTech. My name is Adam Flagg. I hosted actually the first Fast Start way back over a year ago at the Consumer Packaged Goods. We're now on our fifth one that we're doing. So welcome to the new year, 2019 for Fast Start. So what is Fast Start? It's a quarterly pitch competition to support Austin's early entrepreneurs and startups. The event is presented by the City of Austin Small Business Program in partnership with the Austin Young Chamber. So anyone know about AYC here? Do we have any AYC representatives? Good, all right, a lot of members. So the Austin Young Chamber empowers and connects young professionals to create business, community, and individual success. If you're interested in learning more or becoming a member, please grab an information sheet at the registration table out there, or any staff members, if you want to raise your hands, there's a couple back there, one right up here. AYC, I've been involved with AYC for almost a decade now, which makes me not that young anymore. But what I will say is AYC's been tremendously a powerful organization within Austin and has really morphed and changed over time. We have a lot of exciting events coming up, and I'll mention a few of them. One is called the LEAD Summit. It's the only full-day conference for young professionals in Central Texas. Professional development, community, and civic engagement, as well as personal growth, are featured in a day-long event. It's going to be February 15th at Rowling Hall on UT's campus, and tickets are now available on the AYC site, which is austinyc.org. In addition to that, we have other pitch competitions. So if you like pitch competitions, join us again. Have you heard of the reverse pitch competition? That's something that AYC is now in partnership to start doing as well. It's about businesses that are pitching their waste products that could become valuable raw materials for a new or expanding social enterprise. So attend the opening pitch and submit an application for a chance to win a $10,000 innovation prize. That is February 26th at Capital Factory. Let me make sure I hit this. Okay, there we go. So supporting event partners for this quarter are 3-Day Startup, Capital Factory, The Pitch Academy, and Holtzman Partners. Can we give them a round of applause? Not that we aren't already always on camera, but we're actually on real camera right there. This is gonna be live streamed tonight. We'll be able to have a link up for that later so people can check that out. You can find the live stream currently on the Austin Young Chamber Facebook page. So please share and post on social media tonight using the hashtags #AustinFastStart and #FinTech. So again, AustinFastStart, FinTech. Also, restrooms, because I know that could happen, are out the door and across the elevator bank, and you're welcome to go to those there to the right. So let's talk a little bit about how we got here. What is the application process? Let's introduce everyone here and really get going with everything. So, oh, by the way, the reverse pitch I want to mention is actually being held in this room for both the opening pitch as well as the final pitch. So please come back for that. February 26th is that time. So let's explain a little bit about the application process that brought us here today. So in November and December, the Austin Young Chamber accepted applications from FinTech startups here locally and small businesses. FinTech. Are there people that are unfamiliar with FinTech here? I think it's a term thrown around a lot. I know there's plenty. It's a term that's thrown around a lot. So let's define what we define FinTech as. It's described as businesses that leverage new technology to create new and improved financial services for both customers and businesses. It includes companies of all kinds that may operate in personal financial management, insurance, payment, asset management, and more. The applications were scored by 4 judges representing the small business, startup, fintech, and investor communities. From that scoring process, we determined our top 3 finalists who are pitching tonight. I have the pleasure of introducing these judges seated here in front. We'll have you stand and wave to the crowd because I want to make you uncomfortable. Christopher Coviello, AVP, Financial Advisory, Digital Experience and Strategy with USAA. Shayna Dunitz, Director of Operations of 3-Day Startup. Joseph Kelly, Co-Founder and CEO of Unchained Capital. Karthik Srinivasan, Private Investor and Consultant for Srinivasan Family Investors. Thank you, judges, for your time, expertise in the application process as well as tonight. So, the voting process. Who's here to actually change the way who wins? We actually have a part in it in the audience. The number one way is that the audience will have a vote at the end where you'll be able to text in and vote for who you want. But here's how the scoring works. Tonight's winner will be determined by a combination of the judges' score and audience vote. Judges will score each finalist to account for 80% of their score, and the audience vote will account for the remaining 20%. After all three finalists have pitched this evening, we will display a screen with the text number to vote, and you'll be able to cast your vote for who you think made the best pitch. So, now, without further delay, let's get started. Our first pitch is by the business Jump Credit, and John William Meyer, the CEO, will be presenting.
I'll never forget the day that I met Rubin. I was a newly arrived Peace Corps volunteer in rural Peru, trying my best to form a youth group. Rubin sought me out after class. He said, "Profe, I hear you're forming a youth group." I said I was. He said, "Well, hand me one of those permission slips." So I did, not thinking twice. 7 o'clock the next day in the morning rolls around. Rubin's at my door, permission slip in hand. "Profe, when does this group meet?" "Well, we're going to meet on Saturdays." "I'll see you there." And from that Saturday, for the next 2 years of my service, Rubin showed up every single week. I recently caught up with Rubin. He currently works as a cook in an illegal mine. I asked him why he had never studied anything professionally. I knew he had wanted to. He said yes, he had wanted to, but he simply didn't have the money. I asked him if he had ever thought about taking out a loan to finance his studies. He said, "People in Peru don't really do that. They charge exorbitant interest rates," and he was worried that the bank might actually take over his parents' house if he defaulted on the loan. This status quo doesn't make sense. If Rubin is the highly motivated student I know him to be, likely to succeed in his studies and repay back the loan at a profitable interest rate, why isn't the bank originating the loan in the first place? This is the problem Jump Credit will solve. 90% of the world's youth live in developing countries, which means 90% of the world's youth lack access to the financial instruments that can help them unlock their future career and potential. How do we know that student loans can work in developing countries? Lucky for us, we have some serious market validation from the nonprofit Vitana, which existed from 2008 to 2014. Over their 6 years, they made 27,000 loans of an average size of $800. The median increase in income post-studies was 38%, and over a quarter of their borrowers more than doubled their previous income. Their repayment rate, 98%. Vitana's problem was that it lacked the credit technology necessary to get it to operational scale. This is the team that's going to build that credit technology. Tara Panthi is an entrepreneur and co-founder of the national nonprofit in Nepal called Daiwida, which focuses on rural entrepreneurship for women. Sambaba is a former professor from the University of the Gambia. When I told him about the idea, he said, "John, I have to help you come build this, because you have no idea how many of my former students dropped out in their last year or even last semester, not because they lack the drive to finish, but because they lack the tuition payment." This is our three-step solution: application, academics, and repayment. Our model follows the five basic C's of credit: character, capital, capacity, collateral, and conditions. First, the student fills out an application, demonstrates their character by submitting academic data, taking a psychometric test, conducting interviews, and completing reference checks. The information goes into a proprietary algorithm and spits out a Jump Credit score. If the score is high enough, the student is approved for the loan and then puts up innovative capital and collateral. Tuition is then directly paid to the accredited institution, thus mitigating Jump Credit's risk further. The student completes their uninterrupted studies in a high-demand field such as healthcare or education. The student goes on to find gainful employment, which gives them the capacity to repay the loan at fair and profitable interest rates and fair and transparent conditions. Let's take a look at an example in Nepal. A monthly laborer in Nepal can earn $75 per month. With a loan size of $1,000, they can finish the third year of a three-year nursing degree. Upon completion of their degree, they can earn $200 per month. With a payback of $50 per month, even after that $50, they still have more than doubled their previous income. We're not the first people in the world to use an alternative credit structure in the developing world, but we are the first people to use one and target directly the student loan market, which gives us access to academic data, which will increase our predictive strength. This is our revenue model, which has got a little messed up. With 50,000 loans of $1,000 each, we have $50 million loans outstanding. At a 20% simple interest rate, and keep in mind, in developing countries, interest rates are much higher. You can have between over 40 to 200%. We get to a revenue of $7 million annually with a 5% failure rate on our loans. That's actually a higher failure rate than Vitana achieved. Why us? There are two other incredible ideas in this room tonight. But our problem is the one that most desperately needs solving. Our problem is the one that keeps Marianella from becoming a nurse, Jimena from becoming a teacher, and Mary from becoming the doctor she's always dreamed to be. Join us tonight, and we're going to finance the future. Thank you for your time.
John, thanks for your presentation. We're going to keep you up here and keep you in the hot seat. So we're going to first go to the judges. And Mel Martin, who is one of our Austin Young Chamber staff members, is going to be passing around the square mic in a little bit for everyone in the audience. But for now, judges, microphone, who wants to start?
So just kind of a good job. Great job, by the way. Just a couple of kind of more operational questions. One, you meant, what is innovative collateral? What is that? You mentioned the client.
Yeah. Or
the
great question. And that's going to be developed in kind of specific to each country. So with Tara, the co-founder in Nepal, one of the ideas that we've come up with, you know, because it's basically the question is, what type of collateral could an 18-year-old or 19 or 20-year-old possibly have? So in Nepal, for instance, the physical copy of a high school transcript is very valuable. You need it to get future jobs. People want to actually see the physical copy. So that's one idea that we've had as a potential for an innovative type of collateral that an 18-year-old or 20-year-old would have.
Cool, and that's kind of related to my next question. I mean, a lot of these markets are really challenging to deal with, just banking, how even to like wire money into them and get money to somebody, and then you've got foreign transaction fees and things like that. So how have you kind of analyzed the various countries and markets for friendliness for that, and likewise, I mean, even ideas like these collateral bases,
sure,
and just the legal system around these countries can often be murky.
Absolutely. If there's one thing I learned as a Peace Corps volunteer, it's to trust community partners. So the model that we're building is going to have each country will have a specific director. So in the Gambia, it's going to be Samba. In Nepal, it's going to be Tara. And each country is different. We're going to treat each country different. The person on the ground will kind of be in charge of a good deal of the operational aspects of it.
Yeah, really, really great job. I absolutely love this idea. So you mentioned Nepal and Gambia. Are those where you're starting? Are you there right now? Kind of, what does the market
absolutely
look like?
So we're currently, our goal, and I mean, Fast Start is the perfect name for this. Our goal is to launch in 2019 a pilot program. So we have not given out any loans yet, but our goal is to start with the fall class of 2019 in the Gambia. It's a smaller, at the Gambia University, it's a university of about 6,000 students. It's relatively smaller. We have very strong connections there. So that's our plan, is to start there and kind of figure out one country and then figure out what worked there, what didn't, kind of put it into a box and try to take it other places.
And do you anticipate there being any hesitation on the student's side to kind of use something like this, which I'm assuming is completely new to them?
Yeah, and I think that kind of working with community partners, I think it is going to be some sales, because people, I mean, living in Peru, I remember my host family, they were basically attacked by predatory lenders, you know, so there's not a lot of faith around both the formal and informal banking industry. So developing that level of trust through the use of kind of people that they know and partnering with accredited institutions will give more confidence to them, is our hope. So we do plan to partner with accredited institutions as well.
Thanks, John. A very noble mission, so I congratulate you on that. I think that's great. Just a point of clarification. Will you be the lender yourself, or are you going to work with institutions for
yeah,
the lender?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. We plan to be the lender ourselves, especially okay. in the pilot phase, in the scale out to our next round. After pilot, we plan to try to get a USAID grant, Development Innovation Venture grant, yep. Especially at those stages. And later on, I could see potentially partnering with a bank to kind of lend us a line of credit that we're able to get higher returns from due gotcha. To our
okay, that's
system.
Very helpful. So what type of experience do you guys, being a big institution, one of the biggest institutions probably here in this room, an incumbent, what is your experience working with those big institutions? Because I know a point of frustration for startups is yeah. oftentimes working with big institutions saying, we want to go fast, we want to do various things. What's your experience?
In working with
bigger institutions, yeah.
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think from my experience is just, I mean, in Peace Corps was kind of a big institution, but they kind of sent you out there to do what you needed to do. Right. So I think finding the right institutional partnerships for us will be important. That kind of believe in our mission and give us enough autonomy to make change in places that it's sometimes difficult to make change in.
Sure. Yeah, and willing to take the risk, obviously, into something different. So my last question, underdeveloped third world countries, very complicated, understand that space a little bit myself. When we think of someone's digital life, what is it like? How do they interact? You have an approach of very directly, here's an application, fill out this application, you're going to get a loan, how we traditionally see that. Evidence has shown that sometimes can fail easily in third world countries. The example that comes to my mind is microinsure. They wanted to insure people on life insurance policies. And ultimately, what it turned into was buy cell phone minutes and we give you a life insurance policy, as bizarre as that sounds.
Yeah.
How have you thought about how you fit into that digital ecosystem, if at all, into your
yeah.
customer space?
No, and I think that's a great question. So when I left Peru in 2012, I think some people had cell phones. I revisited in 2015. Every single one of my students was, to my chagrin, was on Facebook, following me, messaging me constantly. So there's very much, especially in the youth, there's so much use of technology that we definitely plan to use it. I'm not a huge fan. There are some models that use, for instance, smartphone data, and they're much heavier with machine learning algorithms, kind of black box algorithms where you don't really know why you're not giving the loan. I'm not as big of a fan of those models because I think part of our pilot too is to lend to students that are in their third or fourth year. So a student that's in their third or fourth year definitely knows how to be successful in college. So there's a lot less risk involved. But using Facebook marketing, having a website that people can very much a digital footprint, but not using cell phone data in that way.
I had a question about the data science aspect of your business. And my first question, I guess, is, has your credit scoring model been developed and have you back tested it under various economic scenarios to ensure that the default risk will not be so high that it'll swamp the return potential of the loans?
Yeah, we're currently developing the credit model. So I recently spoke with he's one of the leading experts in educational testing in the US out of Harvard. And we're trying to figure out what has the most predictive strength and kind of build out from there and what data points we're able to gather and which data points we won't be able to gather. So we're still in the development phase of that for the Gambia specifically. So we just pushed our website live, so we're going to start to accept pre-applications and kind of accept data, take a look at it, and figure out what we're able to gather and what we believe will have the most predictive strength.
My second question is the loan approval process and how long you envision that taking, given that acquiring data in some of these countries could be very difficult and the data may not be from reputable sources and trustworthy?
From having worked in startups, my goal will be that the approval process should take a week. I imagine in the beginning it will take longer than that, but the goal will be that the student should be able to get through that process in a week.
Okay, we're going to open it up to the audience. Just so you know the format, it is...
That's all we have time for.
That's all we have time for at all?
Okay.
All right. Well, you guys missed out. We'll try to get through it quicker on the second round so the audience can ask questions too. So we're going to bring up our next finalist. Thank you so much for coming up. Jump Credit. You'll be texting one for Jump Credit. Here is our next finalist, Thomas Young with Rocket Dollar. He's the co-founder and CMO. Welcome.
Thanks, guys. Like you said, my name is Thomas Young. I'm co-founder and chief marketing officer of Rocket Dollar. And tonight we're going to talk about the forgotten trillions and 21st century diversification of a retirement portfolio. Right now in the US, the average American has $84,000 roughly in their retirement account through IRAs and employee-sponsored 401ks. And the top 25% of Americans have $200,000 or more. So this represents a huge pool of capital available for investment. But what's the big problem? The problem is that retirement savings are stuck, and they're stuck in stocks, bonds, and mutual funds. 99.2% of all the investable IRA money today sits in these control-less funds that the individual investor has no say in. And just over 0.8% sits in what we call a self-directed account, which means that they can invest in alternative assets like real estate. So in 2019, we're living in an era where consumers demand control. The days of 60-40, set it and forget it, are over. People demand to be able to do what they want with their money. And that combined with changing financial regulation, making it easier for unaccredited investors to participate in crowdfunding, crowd lending. We all saw the rise and fall of Bitcoin over the last couple years. All of these investments are legally allowed under an IRA. It's just never been easy to do it. So what does Rocket Dollar do? So the Rocket Dollar platform gives investors complete control of their retirement portfolio to invest in anything from real estate to cryptocurrency to startups, basically anything allowed by the IRS. The few things you're not allowed to do, you're not allowed to buy art, collectibles, wine, things that you could then go consume at your kitchen table. So a little bit of the overview. What Rocket Dollar does is set up an account that makes you the driver. You're in the driver's seat. You get a checkbook with all of your retirement money, and you keep all of the tax benefits of an IRA or 401k, whether it's traditional or Roth. And the big thing that Rocket Dollar is also making it easy to do is to take this money and deploy it. So the way that on eBay you had the PayPal button, when soon you'll be able to deploy funds through the Rocket Dollar button on any of the investment platforms around today. So think you go on Yield Street and you see a great real estate offering in Florida and you want to do it, you will be able to fund it with your IRA or 401k through the Rocket Dollar button. So what we've really done is taken a process that's existed for about 15, 16 years and made it easy. There's a lot of small, we'd call mom and pop shops, that do this in a very expensive, complex, paper-heavy way, where it takes months to get an account funded, it costs thousands of dollars, and you have no protections. They basically give you your money and say, have fun, and they don't guide you through the process of making an alternative investment, or even if it's an allowed or disallowed investment. There's some rules around who you can invest with. For example, you can't buy a house with your mom. That's not allowed. So nobody tells you this. They just sell you an account, and good luck finding their customer support number. So what we really want to do is make this process easy and democratize it for any American with a retirement account. So that's what we've done so far. We launched in early 2018, and right now that's what you're able to do. But as a company, we want to do more than that. And we want to be a vertically integrated trust company for the sole purpose that we want you to be able to do everything under the Rocket Dollar umbrella. And that includes building in a robo-advisor, think Betterment or Wealthsimple or any of these guys that let you buy mutual funds in a very cheap way. And we're offering that in March of this year. for you to be able to not only buy alternative assets inside your retirement account, but also use our robo-advisor to also have a mix of funds. So this is our team. Henry Yoshida couldn't be here tonight. He's our CEO. Rick Dude, our other co-founder, is here tonight. But the great thing about this team is that everybody's committed to customer success and making a scary, intimidating process simple. We're dealing with people's retirement money. It's their life savings, and we want people to get the most that they possibly can out of it. Thank you.
Right, judges, who wants to go first?
So one question is just about how y'all view yourselves as somewhat of a fiduciary. I've seen these platforms come up that help people invest in Bitcoin or cryptocurrencies in their IRAs, which are really pretty risky investments. And I kind of find it distasteful to try to advertise like how easy to make it to put your retirement funds and stuff like Ripple Coin or something. So how do you guys view that and think about that?
Yeah, so really our real thought around the fiduciary responsibility is that no one has their best interest more at heart than the person. Now, there are some incredibly risky investments that you could make with this account, but we feel that it's everybody's right to be able to make that investment. Now, whenever you're considering an investment, we don't advocate firing your financial advisor. You should still talk to whoever it walks you through the process. We just think that you should be able to do it should you desire that level of risk. And if it pays off, you don't pay taxes.
So you talked about wanting to democratize this process for every American. But right now I'm not your customer, right? Like definitely don't have that kind of money. Don't really know what a lot of this was about. So who are your early adopters? Who are your current customers right now?
Yeah, so our biggest investments made out of our accounts right now is real estate. So it's folks that identify a property down the street from maybe where they live, or they're multifamily real estate investors, and they want to accelerate what they're already doing. So most of our customers have already been investing with cash, essentially, and they just found a way to tap into probably their largest pool of savings, and they're just accelerating what they're doing.
Many of the alternative investment options that you talked about are open typically for accredited investors only. So I'm just curious what portion of the market you're really going to be able to address with your solution, given that many of the potential users of the platform are not going to be accredited, and so they will not be allowed to invest in private placements, for example, in startups, even some of the real estate investments that you talked about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so with the changing landscape, crowdfunding, crowd lending, all of these things are growing, and we anticipate that they will continue growing. The accreditation question is one that comes up a lot, and unfortunately, it's still on the investment, right? It's not on ours to determine who's accredited and who's not. So as more offerings become available, crowdfunding moves more into the mainstream, we see the opportunity for people to use these accounts to grow. And there are always going to be real estate investments that will always be accredited. And unfortunately, we don't have a way to solve for that yet. But we see the alternative space continuing to grow.
Thanks again for your time. The idea of a self-directed IRA is nothing new, right? I think you guys are just lowering the barriers to entry. I was going to ask the question of like who this is good for. I think you've already answered that in several ways. But from a slightly different perspective, and hopefully this doesn't come across in the wrong way, why would I want Bitcoin in my retirement accounts?
So for the simple reason that, from in 2017, we saw a huge run with insane returns, and the tax treatment of those investments was horrible. And if had you done that inside of a Rockadollar account, you could have enjoyed the 200-400% gain and deferred taxes until retirement, or if you'd been in a Roth Rockadollar account, you would have never paid taxes on that investment.
So it's just to clarify too, it's really to invest in the esoterics that may be out of someone's typical reach, but also to take benefits from a tax perspective is really what you're focusing on. You're thinking that the self-direct is more about the tax benefit versus the accessibility of the esoterics.
Yeah, so the biggest advantage of doing something through a Rockefeller account versus cash is the tax treatment that you're going to have on that investment, on the returns.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Great. Judging panel has gone. We're going to open it up to the audience. Who has a question? All right, Alex.
Hi, am I supposed to use that microphone or is this okay? Okay, thanks. Quick question. So I get the self-directed IRA part, but you also said that you were going to have a robo-advisor arm. And kind of going back to the risk, fiduciary responsibility on your part, what is that robo-advisor going to be offering? Are they going to be saying, you should put 5% in Bitcoin, you should put 20% in real estate, or is it going to be more of those bland, you know, stocks, bonds, mutual funds that you talked about at the beginning?
Yeah, so it'll be the bland stocks, bonds, mutual funds that I said in the beginning. The real reason for the robo-advisor is to make it easy between moving from, you know, the traditional offerings while potentially waiting for a deal to come across your desk, or if you're you know, just getting started in self-directed investment, making alternative investments, it's an easy way to have that predetermined mix, depending on the risk you want to take in mutual funds, you know, in the market essentially, but make it really easy to have everything housed under one umbrella and track your overall return from your maybe real estate all the way through to your stocks and bonds. But we won't tell you if you should have 5% or 3% or 2%. That will always be on you.
Okay, we still have time for more questions. Who wants to question Thomas here?
What will your fees look like?
Yeah, so our pricing model is incredibly simple. We charge $360 to set up the account and $15 a month in a compliance fee. So that means we take care of all the paperwork associated with your account. Then that's all we charge.
Last question? No? All right, let's give a round of applause for Rocket Dollar.
Thank you.
Now it's time for our third and final pitch tonight. I'm going to bring up Tixpire. That's Devin Laughlin. He's the owner, and he's going to give us his pitch.
Check. I'd like to ask all of you to think back to the last live event that you attended. It may have been a music festival, it may have been a business seminar, and it may have even been skydiving. Now I'd like you to think about the relationships that you formed at that event. I'd like you to think about the personal improvement that you gained, and I'd like you to think about the costs. That last one hurts. My business partner and I agree. So we started Tixpire. We help dreamers attend more life-changing events worldwide by offering extended payment plans to any ticketed event. This again includes the obvious, music, sports, comedy, but it also includes business seminars and special events like skydiving. So the problem is that these positive life-changing events are highly unaffordable. We took metrics across several sports ticketing agencies, over $24 billion in revenue in 2018, one single music ticketing agency, LiveNation.com, that doesn't include any others, and a few comedy venues, one special event, a business seminar with 10 special visitors. That one event brought over $100 million in revenue, and altogether brings the market to well over $33 billion in 2018 alone. Now the solution is simple. We offer low-cost event payment plans to any ticketed event, and we currently have a working website where people can come request any event be put on a payment plan simply by dropping their URL into our payment form. Now my business partner and I met in Miami, and over the frustration of not being able to attend a week-long festival and during Miami Music Week, started Tixpire. He's my amazing tech lead. He does all the software engineering and development, and I deal with the day-to-day business operations. So our business model is simple. We charge a 5% flat fee on any ticket payment plan. We're also in development of a mobile application. We found that 67% of users buy their tickets on their mobile device. We also have two other forms of revenue. We charge a monthly or yearly membership fee to VIP members that offers them up to 0% down to 0% fees. And exclusive access, early access, to several ticketed events. Our last form of revenue is partnerships. We've created a partnership with a local company in Austin. This company sends their customers around the world on luxury travel retreats. And we're also in the process of forming a partnership with an event that I can't quite name. You may have heard of them. They have a week-long festival here in Austin in March. Now, our competition, we have one major competitor, Tixer Ticketing. They currently offer payment plans to a few live events. The problem is that they charge up to 15% on top of the face value ticket price. They don't pull a credit report, but they only partner with a few events, and it's for a very limited amount of time. Now, the obvious indirect competitors are personal loans and credit cards. These are for anybody that can get approved. The problem is, again, that they charge up to 33% interest depending on your credit score and the amount you've requested. If you can get approved and reapproved several times, you can use it as many times as you want. Now, TixBuyer puts the best of all of these together. We charge a flat 5% fee. We never touch your credit, and anybody can use us at any time for any event. So far, who's buying? Our target market and the people that are buying from us are millennials, ages 20 to 35 years old. Now, last year, 35% of live music attendees were millennials. They prefer experiential treatment over things. They don't like credit card debt. They typically have lower income, and they typically have smaller or no families. We also focus on the top live event cities in the United States. Always in the top five are Las Vegas, Chicago, New York, my partner's home, Miami, and our personal home, Austin, Texas. So far, we've raised $3,000. We've bootstrapped $3,000. We've spent that money on tickets, legal fees, and marketing. And if we're so lucky to win the hearts and minds of all of you today, we'll continue to not only create amazing experiences for fun and enjoyment, but help business professionals build on certifications and seminars they may not yet be able to afford. So think back again to that last live event. Think about the relationships that you formed. Think about the personal gain that you gained, personal improvements you gained, and think about how much fun you had. Because hopefully now cost is not a stress. Thank you.
Thank you, Devin with TixBuyer. Who wants to start? We haven't had anyone like Simon. Is any going to be a tough judge here?
Great job. So do you have any current customers? Are you generating revenue right now?
We do. So the $3,000 that we've spent so far has been at approximately $2,000 in ticket sales. We're currently making that back. We haven't had a single default, and we're making that back over the period of the maturity of that payment.
You mentioned default. What are you doing? What's the recourse? Why would I just not pay you after I get the loan?
So as collateral, we keep the ticket. If I buy a ticket in your name, I hold on to it. That covers our legal issues. We're not reselling a ticket. We're buying the ticket for you. We hold it as collateral until you pay it off. And so far, we buy the ticket at wholesale, at whole price, face value. We charge you face value plus our flat 5% fee, and we hold on to it as collateral.
You have to buy months in advance and pay you back by the event?
Up to 30 days before. So as long as we have 2 weeks before the event to pay it off, that essentially allows you one payment cycle if you get paid bi-monthly. That's what we've done. Correct. It has to be paid off until before the event.
How did you come up with the 5% fee as the right price to charge for the service, you know, given the default risk would seem to be pretty high, notwithstanding what you just talked about?
So quickly to address the default risk, so far we haven't had an issue, and we are looking at the resale value of our tickets. We don't mark up tickets no matter what. And so to cover default, we leave the 2 weeks advance. If somebody defaults, we give them 48 hours notice, and then we resell the ticket at face value. So we've made at least our fees and then resell the ticket just to make the cost of the ticket back. Now, the flat 5%, we looked at payment processors, essentially, because we're developing a lot more in technology. It's a little bit higher than a payment processor, but it's not near as high as a credit card or a loan or even the one company that already offers ticket payment plans.
And the ticket procurement is done directly from the venue or whatever kind of ticket agent they're using?
Correct. Okay, so
you're paying retail prices, no volume-based advantages on that front?
The great thing about us is that because we don't focus on partnerships, we focus on the consumer ticket or the consumer buying. We can buy a ticket directly from Ticketmaster. It's a little bit higher priced, but again, we don't charge a markup on the ticket. So if tickets sell out, as they usually do, we can still offer a payment plan on a highly variable ticket price. As soon as we buy it, it's locked in and they know what they're going to pay.
So you mentioned competitively price, accessibility, let's call it ease of entry because of the credit report.
Yes.
But what about long term? Where do you think you would go if you have some short term success? How do you differentiate?
So again, it's myself and my business partner. He does a lot of he does all of the software engineering. We're looking at how we can use financial technology to improve the ticketing experience overall. So this is essentially our minimum viable product, the website that we offer. We're building a mobile application. There are APIs that exist to make us a ticketing platform. As we build partnerships, we put face value tickets on our website, just like any other ticketing platform. And we're looking at ways that we can use blockchain and implement that into ticketing and the payment aspect of ticketing as well.
Any other questions from the judges panel? All right, open it up to the audience. Who wants to talk about tickets?
Have you thought about going into airfare or airline tickets?
So there is a company that already exists that I found after I started this, because the idea was that we could purchase a ticket, and let's just say South by Southwest, for instance, if you come from out of town, we can pay for the hotel as part of the event, but we cannot pay for the airline as part of the event because of the company that already exists.
Okay, another question? All right, you're making me walk. Do you have it?
Yeah, it's
Is
working.
Is it working?
It's working.
What? Talk right into it.
What? Serious? Whoa, wow, this is an actual microphone. So I'm curious about scalping laws. So you mentioned that when, you know, someone defaults, you're holding the ticket as collateral, basically ready to resell it. Would reselling it be considered scalping in any states where scalping might be illegal?
So we've looked a lot into this. Some of the money that we are going to start redirecting is towards legal fees. Now, no, to answer your question, no. We've covered every aspect that we can. In Texas, scalping laws are very limited, and that doesn't mean that they're not more strict in other states. But if need be, we pay a transfer fee to transfer tickets to buyers. So essentially, we resell it and offer it to somebody else at face value again and pay the transfer fee with the fees that we've already collected. We don't lose any money that way. We don't break any laws. If we cannot transfer it, we put it on Ticketmaster or any resale site that already exists. Again, at face value.
So you guys are only in Texas right now, or?
So my business partner lives in Miami, and we've been selling events all over the nation. We're currently based in Austin, Texas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, last question. Anyone else have anything for Devin? You've got to throw the mic if someone raises their hand. All right, well, we'll wrap that up. Devin, thank you so much for your presentation.
You
Ticketspire. So let's talk about the presentations. We had three high quality fintech companies here in Austin that have bright ideas, some of them at different stages in their development. But we'll talk about Jump Credit. So John, thank you so much for presenting. Thomas from Rocket Dollar and Devin from Ticketspire. These presentations have continued to get better as we go through more and more of these fast starts. We're really impressed by your slide deck. The judges really spent time researching what you guys do. So now we're going to kind of open it up to the second half, the dramatic part of what we're doing. So let's talk about voting. Let's see here. Yes, it works. Okay, so at this time, we're going to give you 5 minutes to text your vote to the Austin Fast Start FinTech business with the best pitch. Instructions are on the screen now. I feel like Ryan Seacrest. So we're going to text one for Jump Credit, two for Rocket Dollar, three for Ticketspire, in exactly the same order that they gave their presentation. And you're going to text that number 517-305-8226. If you have any problems or you're not tech savvy, which would be weird if you're here, but if you're having problems with texting, raise your hand and we'll all laugh at you and then we can get you texted in. So I'm just going to hit pause here. We're going to come back here in about 5 minutes, and I've been told that I could potentially play the Jeopardy song, so we're going to do that from Spotify. We do want to thank the official vote tabulation company, the sponsor tonight, Holtzman Partners. They're a full-service accounting firm, and they actually are recording all the votes right now. We should know very, very soon. Do we know? We do know. Okay. There's like smoke coming from like a chimney, and we do know who is going to be the next Fast Start winner. So let me talk about the prize pack. So here is what the prize is involved. I want to thank all of the donors, everyone that's been involved in this. First of all, $2,500 cash prize from the City of Austin. In-kind prizes are valued at about $5,000. That involves a one-year elite membership to the Austin Young Chamber, 3 months of free rent to Capital Factory, global conference roundup ticket from 3-Day Startup. Thank you, Shane and team. LLC formation. So if you need legal formation, the Haney Law Firm is our sponsor for that. And then there's a business coaching session from the Economic Growth Business Incubator. So lots and lots of prizes here. I want to invite up a representative from the City of Austin, Veronica Samo. She's the Business Information Coordinator for the City of Austin Small Business Program, to the stage to present the winner.
Good evening. I am Veronica Samo, and I'm with the City of Austin Small Business Program. We're a division of the Economic Development Department, so that means that we exist to provide entrepreneurs with business training. We host events throughout the year, and we even have one-on-one business coaching. So we have a few representatives in the room, and you should have some materials at each of your seats if you want to reach out, and we can help connect you to small business resources. I want to close this evening with a sincere thanks. First, to all of you for joining us today, hearing these pitches, and helping select tonight's winner. I'd also like to thank each of the finalists in the fintech industry. We admire your entrepreneurial spirit, and I know we all enjoyed hearing what your small business ideas are. We're thrilled to be able to partner with the Austin Young Chamber on these events. We really appreciate they take the lead and just provide seamless coordination to bring this all together. So a big thanks goes out to AYC. And also to Capital Factory for hosting us today. I think we can all agree this is a great setting and a good fit for the fintech category. Now, the moment that we're all waiting for, I want to invite Adam Steele, our AYC board member, to the stage to help present the prize. So it is my honor to announce our Austin Fast Start FinTech winner, Jump Credit. All right, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you all for attending. I want to make sure we recognize the judges again for the time they put in. So Chris Coviello from USAA, Shana Dunnett, 3-Day Startup, Joseph Kelly, Unchained Capital, and Karthik Chirinasivan from the Chirinasivan Family Private Investor. So thank you again to all the attendees and all the finalists. You guys all made great presentations, and Jump Credit, congratulations on the big win. I want to mention the next Fast Start event is actually going to be in June, so we've got a little time off, but it's going to be about fashion. So hopefully we'll see all of you guys back in the room for a totally different topic. It's going to be a whole lot of fun. You're going to look for applications on the Austin Young Chamber website, which again is austinyc.org. That's it. Good night. Thank you so much.